All right, why don't you open your Bibles to 2 Timothy chapter 2 this morning? 2 Timothy chapter 2, that's where we'll spend a bulk of our time. The Bible describes us all just like this empty vessel right here. At our core, that's what we are. We're a vase, a vessel, a container that has been fitted and formed by our Maker to contain something, to hold something that is of great treasure, of great value. Our purpose is to be a home, a house, a dwelling place for the Holy Spirit. But when you look around our culture, you look around our country today, you can see that we live in a very sinful, fallen state, don't we? I mean, you turn on the news and you can see that. 50 people, they've counted so far, dead this morning in Orlando. Another 53 or so injured at last count. Taking of other human life so flippantly. Never an excuse, right? We need Jesus like never before. We need the Holy Spirit in our culture like never before. But here's the thing, not only in our culture, but in our church, our local church, this church, we do not contain the Holy Spirit the way we should contain the Holy Spirit, the way the Holy Spirit wants to dwell within us because we've become unclean. Our vessels are dirty. Our vessels are tainted. Our vessels look disgusting to the Lord, and He can't fill a disgusting vessel. He will not fill a disgusting vessel. He expects the vessel to be clean and to be pure so that He can dwell there within. Listen, my friends, we have all been fooled into this line that we have to pay attention to what we do and what we don't do, especially what we don't do. Our religion, quote-unquote religion, our relationship and our standing with God, we have come to base upon the fact that we don't do this or we don't do that. I don't sin in that way or I don't sin in this way. That's a lie from the pit of hell. That's not what our relationship is based upon. Jesus was asked, what's the greatest command of all? Do you remember that? And Jesus replied, he said, the greatest command of all is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And the second is like it, which is to love your neighbor as yourself. That's the greatest command, to love God. But in our culture, and even in our church, we've become known more for what we stand against than what we stand for. I don't want to be known for what I stand against. I want to be known for what I stand for, by the fact that I stand for a God of grace, a God of love, a God of mercy, a God who wants to give Himself completely to us if we'll receive Him. That's what I want to be known for. And when we fall into the trap of making our relationship with God based more upon making sure we don't do this or don't do that, we neglect the most important things. What Jesus said was the most important thing, which is to love God with everything you've got. To give Him everything, and then to love your neighbor as yourself. Why does He say that? Because if you love God with everything, if you're loving God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, you don't have to worry about the Ten Commandments. You don't have to worry about not taking God's name in vain. You don't have to worry about not honoring the Sabbath. You don't have to worry about making a carved image. You don't have to worry about worshiping an idol because you love God with everything. I love God completely. Why would I do any of those things? When you love your neighbor as yourself, you don't have to worry about coveting your neighbor's donkey. Right? You don't have to worry about jealousy. You don't have to worry about murder. You don't have to worry about lying to people. You don't have to worry about honoring your mother and father. When you love your neighbor as yourself, none of those things are going to happen. Church, we need to be no more about what we stand for than what we stand against. And I want to carry the name of Jesus out in this community, and I want to invade darkness with light. And we have the opportunity to do that as the church. But the church has been largely fooled. Check it out. This is what happened. Jesus was approached by some people, and He says, listen, your disciples are eating without washing their hands. What's going on there? Why is that possible? Why is that happening? How can you allow them to eat without washing their hands the proper way? And Jesus says, you don't understand. It's not what goes into a man that defiles the man. It's what comes out of the man. That's what defiles the man. The man isn't unclean because of what he eats. That's ridiculous. The man is unclean because there's sin in his heart. And when the sin is in the heart, the sin comes out in the life of a person. Amen. Jesus says, no, you don't get it. That's what defiles a man. The word defiles means to make common. Listen to me, my friends. None of you were created to be common. But when we have sin and we regard sin in our hearts and we allow sin to fester in our hearts and to make us unclean, the scripture says that we defile ourselves. We become common. God doesn't want to use a common individual. God wants to use an uncommon individual. He wants to use someone spectacularly, and he wants to use you spectacularly, but you have to cleanse the cup. You have to cleanse the vessel. You see? So we've been fooled, yes, but you have to see this. The God, he doesn't look at the outside of this vessel. He sees the heart. He sees your heart. 1 Samuel chapter 16, what does the scripture say? But the Lord said to Samuel, do not look at his appearance or his physical stature. Speaking of David, I understand he's the runt of the litter. I understand he's not the biggest, the strongest, the best looking. But you know what? I don't look on the outward appearance, God said. This is what he says. For the Lord does not see as man sees. For man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. What does your heart look like to the Lord this morning? Have you been fooled into making your walk with Christ about making sure you don't do this and don't do that, rather than loving God and loving your neighbor with everything? Don't be fooled. Second, we need to be cleansed. We need to be cleansed, and the only way that you can really truly be cleansed is when you do just as Jesus says in Matthew chapter 23. He's rebuking, that's a strong word, he's warning, he's rebuking the scribes and the Pharisees because they love to play the part of the religious person. Jesus said at one time, they love to stand on the corners of the street and to pray really loud and long prayers because they think everyone is watching them and hearing them. Don't be like that guy. Jesus says, don't be like that guy. When you pray, you go into your secret place, in your inner sanctum, in that place where God meets with you and you alone, and you pour your heart out to God there because God sees in secret. Right? Don't be that guy, Jesus says. Don't be that guy. And this is what he says directly to them. He says, woe to you, scribes, you Pharisees and hypocrites, for you cleanse the outside of the container, the outside of the dish, but the inside are full of extortion and self-indulgence. You blind Pharisee, first cleanse the inside of the cup and dish, that the outside of them may be clean also. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees and hypocrites, for you are like whitewashed tombs, which indeed appear beautiful outwardly, but inside they're full of dead men's bones and uncleanness. Even so, you also outwardly appear righteous to men, but inside you're full of hypocrisy and lawlessness. Listen to me. God doesn't care what you don't do. God is worried about what you do do. The scribes and Pharisees, they had it down. They lived by the law the best they could. I mean, every jot, every tittle. Jesus said to them, you swallow a camel and you strain out the gnat. The gnat was the smallest of the unclean animals. And when they would eat soup, they would make sure there were no gnats there. Jesus says, you pay attention to make sure there's not a gnat in your soup, but you're swallowing camels, which is the largest unclean animal. He says, it makes no sense the way you live. You think by keeping all these rules and regulations and rituals that you're pleasing me, but you're not. Because I see the inside of the cup. It doesn't matter that you look right on the outside. It doesn't matter that everyone looks up to you and thinks that you're religious and righteous and perfect. Because I see your heart and you are not. In Isaiah chapter 6, Isaiah sees this vision of God and his holiness, and he cries out, woe is me, for I am undone. He sees God in all of his holiness. He says, woe is me. I am an unclean man, and I dwell in the midst of an unclean people. My lips are unclean, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. So take the coal and cleanse my lips. Take that burning coal and touch it to my lips to take away that sinfulness, that impurity. I don't care that it's going to hurt because I see you in your glory and in your holiness, and that's all I desire. Is that your heart this morning? Man, to love God like that. I don't care that it's going to hurt God. Take the coal and burn away everything that doesn't please you, because I want to please you. Do you feel dirty this morning? Because listen, God doesn't care what happened last night. He doesn't care what happened last week. He doesn't care about the words you said to your wife last night. He doesn't worry about what you watched last night. Do you know what God is concerned with? Is right now, this moment, are you going to give it up? Are you going to surrender it? Are you going to lay it down? Are you going to say, take that coal and burn away this junk? Because I don't desire it any longer. You can be cleansed this morning. You don't have to live your life in bondage. You don't have to live your life a slave. You don't have to be shackled in that sin any longer. Jesus says this, or the word says this, come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins were as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. They were red like crimson, yet they shall be like the wool of a sheep. Will you come to God today and say, God, I don't want this any longer. I don't want the sin hanging over my head. Listen, the remedy is simple. James chapter 4 says this, therefore submit to God, resist the devil, and he will what? He will flee from you. Draw near to God. Approach God. Approach God with hands raised high. Approach God with your empty vessel, with a cup that has nothing in it. Approach God. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you, the scripture says. You take those steps, and he will meet you in that place. Then it says, cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Lament and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned into mourning, your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he will lift you up. You can be cleansed this morning if you will approach God with your empty vessel and say, God, I need you. Cleansed, forgiven, set free. That's the promise that awaits you if you'll draw near to God this morning. So you need to be cleansed, yes, but you also need to be clothed. Now, how many of you get all dressed up to go out for a fancy dinner? You get dressed and you put on your clothing first and you say, you know what? I maybe should have showered first. Nobody does that, right? You shower first, you're cleansed first, and then you get clothed, right? It's the same way spiritually. We have to be cleansed first, and then we can come to Christ, and we get clothed. Now, Paul says this in the book of Colossians. He says that we're supposed to put off all of these, the traits of the old man. We put off anger and wrath and malice and blasphemy and filthy language out of our mouths. We put off all of these things in Colossians chapter 3. Put it off. The word means to unclothe yourself. It means to take it off, to shred away, to tear off, the old man, to let it fall at your feet, the old clothing, the old rags, the old sinfulness, the stench of the old man, to let it fall at your feet. But then he follows that up. He says this in verse 10, but you should put on the new man who is renewed in knowledge according to the image of who created him. So you put on the new man. You unclothe the old man in its wrath and malice and anger and greed and lust and all of the sin. You take all of that off. You cast it off. You throw it away. And you get to put on the new man that is renewed according to the knowledge of Jesus. Have you put on that new man this morning? You see, here's the thing. We spend a lot of time grooming, don't we? And it's okay. Grooming is important. You know what? I'm going to tell you how important grooming is. Last night, we went out for milkshakes after 8 o'clock at Sonic because they're half price. How many of you like half price milkshakes? I love half price milkshakes. So we went in, and the line was long, so we went inside the restaurant, and I'm there holding Abby's hand, and I've shared this with you before, but I'm kind of like really particular. I want to make sure everybody has their order before I get to the restaurant. I don't want to be waiting for them to decide. So we've decided, and I walk in with Abby, and Abby's like looking at the menu, and she's looking up at me, and she's trying to say something to me, and I'm a little bit annoyed. And I'm holding her hand, and I'm like, we already discussed this. We already decided what you wanted, right? And that's what I'm thinking in my heart, but this cashier is waiting to talk to me, and she says, and I said, you said you wanted the brown sugar one. What happened? You wanted brown sugar? And she says, yes, but Daddy, and she's covering her mouth like this. Yes, but Daddy,
But Eddie, and so I said, oh, what is it? What is it? Daddy, you have a booger in your nose.
And I thought, I need to listen to her more often. So I have to wipe my nose. She still wanted the brown sugar. Everything was okay, but I had a booger hanging out of my nose because I didn't groom. I didn't check the mirror before I went inside. Here's the thing, right? We do this all of the time spiritually. We neglect spiritually our grooming. We don't cleanse ourselves. We don't bathe ourselves in the Word. We don't make sure that we're clothed in Christ, that we're clothed in the new man. We don't do that the way we should. And I wonder if spiritually we're walking around with stuff hanging out of our nose or stuck in our teeth because God sees us spiritually, not just physically. Now, listen, we spend $55 billion annually on cosmetics. $55 billion annually. Around $200 per woman per year is what they say. And that over the course of a lifetime, it equals $15,000. And they figured this out. If you invested that $15,000 in a personal IRA, by the time you were 70, you would have $100,000, right? But we put this towards our physical appearance. This is the attention we pay towards our physical appearance. And here, this blows my mind, right? But they did a survey, and they found out that 21% of women take longer than 30 minutes a day to get ready, to prepare themselves physically, all right? That counts shower, makeup, clothing, all that. 25% of men took longer than 30 minutes. More men were taking longer than women. That blew my mind. I can't even imagine why a guy would take 30 minutes to get ready. What are you guys doing? Right? But then I thought about it. I thought, well, you know, I got to oil my beard. I gotta put some beard balm in. I gotta do my hair now because I have a little bit of it up there now, right? It doesn't take anywhere near that amount of time, but what would the church look like if we each spent 30 minutes a day preparing ourselves spiritually to go out and to meet the world? Amen. What power would there be in the church? Would our culture be changed? Would our communities be changed? Would our families be changed if we spent that time in the presence of Jesus? It would, wouldn't it? We need to be clothed. We need to be clothed in Christ. Listen to Romans 13, 14, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ. It's the same term in the Greek. To put on the new man, put on Jesus. We talk about putting on the armor of God, right? You need to clothe yourself in Jesus. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ. Put him on. And make no provision for the lust of the flesh to fulfill its lust. You put on Jesus. So our vessels as a church, our vessels as individuals, we've become unclean because we've been fooled and we haven't been cleansing ourselves or clothing ourselves. But not only is the problem that we've become unclean, but because we've become unclean, we've become unusable. We've become unusable. Look at this text now in 2 Timothy chapter 2, beginning in verse 20. It says, but in a great house, there are not only vessels of gold and silver, but also of wood and clay, some for honor and some for dishonor. Therefore, if anyone cleanses himself from the latter, he will be a vessel for honor, sanctified and useful for the master, prepared for every good work. That is what I want my vessel to be. I want to be useful. I want to be sanctified. I want to be prepared. I want God to be able to use me. But because we've become unclean, God won't use us. I want this church to be used. I want you as a believer in Christ to be used powerfully by God. I pray over my children that God uses them exponentially more than God uses me, because I want that to go forth. I want power to go forth from their lives. And I want power to go forth in your life and from your life. I want God to use you. But if you're going to be used, you have to see yourself as someone who is valued. You have to see yourself as valued. Now, when this text says that in the great house there are not only vessels of gold and of silver, but also wood and clay, some for honor and some for dishonor, that word honor there, it means to be valued. It means to have a value. I think we're having some trouble, so you can write that in there. We have to be valued. First point, we have to be seen as valued. The word honor means a price. It means something of great worth. It means something of value. And so in a house, there are vessels that are used that are valuable, that have an important use, or maybe even the vessel itself is of great value or of great worth. Now, in 1 Thessalonians, Paul says this to the church in Thessalonica. He says, you need to know how to possess your vessel in sanctification and in honor. You need to begin to see yourself as someone who is valuable and someone who is worth something. Then he goes on to say, if you would see yourself that way, you wouldn't be involved in sexual sin. You wouldn't be involved in sexual immorality because you would see your vessel as something that is valuable. Listen to me, church. Sexual sin is running rampant, not only in our culture, but in our church. And when you see your vessel as something that is valued, something that has great worth, you won't put yourself in that place. When you realize that Jesus went to a cross so that you can have a relationship with God once again, that's your value. That is your worth. You're not going to give that away flippantly. You're not going to sleep around. You're not going to watch pornography all the time. You're not going to cause another person to sin so that you can watch it for your own gratification. The scripture says in 1 Thessalonians, you're taking advantage of that person when you do that. You're crossing a line, literally, it says in 1 Thessalonians. Don't cross that line. You have to see yourself as something that is great, has great value and great worth. It begins there. There are vessels for honor and dishonor. And he goes on, he says, therefore, if anyone cleanses himself, there's that word again, right? If anyone cleanses himself from the latter, from the dishonor, from the unvaluable things, only pay attention to those things which are valuable. If you cleanse yourself from those dishonorable things, he will be a vessel for honor. He will be a valuable vessel, sanctified. We must, as a church, desire to be sanctified. That's your next point. You must desire to be sanctified. Write that down. The word literally means to be set apart, to be made holy, to be used by God. That God has a work that he's doing in your life to set you apart, to prepare you so that he can use you. Do you hear that? God wants to use you. God doesn't just want to use me. God doesn't want to just use a pastor or a worship leader. He wants to use every single one of you. Jesus says this in John chapter 17. He says, sanctify them by truth. Your word is truth. And then he goes on and he says, I have sanctified myself so that I can sanctify them. I have set myself apart, set myself aside, so that they can be set aside. The word sanctify, to separate, to set apart. Listen, can you hear God's voice calling to you today, saying, come away with me. Leave all of the filth. Leave all of the junk. Leave all of the trash and come be separate with me. Come be holy with me. It's an invitation in the scripture. God says to us, be holy as I am holy. Come be with me. Come be separated with me. It's an invitation. He's beckoning you. He's whispering into your heart. He's calling you to come. Have you responded yet? Hebrews 10:10 says, by that will we have been sanctified or set apart through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. He went to a cross so that we could be set apart. He came to this earth as a baby so that we could be set apart. So we have to be sanctified. We need to desire to be sanctified. Now, our vessel must be consecrated. That's the word that the Old Testament uses for the word sanctified. It's consecrated. And in the Old Testament, in Exodus chapter 30, you can read this later on, there was a special oil, a special anointing oil that was made from spices and olive oil. And they would use that oil to anoint all of the utensils, all of the vessels that were used in worship inside the tabernacle and inside the temple. Before the vessel could be used by God in worship to God, it had to be anointed and it had to be consecrated. So here we are, this consecration. It would be consecrated. They would anoint them, and it says this, so they shall be consecrated, that they may be most holy, and so that whatever touches them may be holy. So first off, they were consecrated, dedicated, prepared, made holy. But the priests and the utensils also had to be anointed. So this anointing has to take place in their lives. This oil, in order for them to be consecrated, had to be poured out. The word anointed means to take oil and to pour on the head of. And I was anointed in this way once before. I went on a missions trip. And I was standing in a circle, and the people who had invited us to this trip, it's called City of Refuge. It's in downtown San Diego, and they basically do church in the community. They don't even have a church. They just are the church. They just be the church. They are the church, right? So I'm there, and they came up behind me, and they had a flask of oil, and they just emptied it on my head, and it just ran down everywhere. That's anointing. And they laid hands on me, and they prayed over me, and they prayed an amazing prayer that God would use me. But that's anointing, where God empties that oil on the head, right? Now, reason with me here just for a moment, because it was so important in the New Testament that the early church was anointed by God so that they could change the world. Without the Holy Spirit's anointing, we can't do anything. We are useless without God's Spirit being poured out upon the church. It says of Stephen that they selected him to just wait on tables. Do you hear that? He was a waiter. They selected him because he was a man who was full of the Holy Spirit. The word full means that it's filled to capacity. It contains all that it can possibly contain. And that's the way we're supposed to be anointed as believers. I want my vessel to be filled to the point that it cannot contain any more. I've been listening to this song a lot lately by Bethel. It's called Pieces. And one of the lyrics in this song, it says, God doesn't give himself. He doesn't give his heart to us in pieces. God doesn't want to give a little bit of himself to you. He wants to flood you with himself. He wants to anoint you with his Spirit. He wants to fill you to overflowing. But the problem is we have too much other garbage in our containers. You have to empty the container before God will fill you up with his Spirit. You have to pour all of that worthless stuff out. Here's what the scripture says in Titus chapter 3. It says that God, when he saved us through the washing and the regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Spirit, that he poured out on us abundantly the Spirit. He poured out abundantly through Jesus Christ, our Savior. He poured that out abundantly, not just a little here and there. He emptied it on us. So a vessel has to be anointed, but the vessel also must be washed. And before these priests could be used in the worship of the temple, they were bathed from head to toe. It was like a baptism. They were completely cleansed. But then every time they walked in to serve in the tabernacle, they had to stop at a bronze laver, and they had to wash their hands and their feet in the bronze laver. They had to be washed in that water before they were fit to be used inside the worship of worshiping inside the tabernacle. When was the last time you stopped and said, God, I want to be washed. I want to be clean. I don't want to limit what you can do in my life because I'm regarding sin, because I have sin on my hands and I have sin on my feet. I want to be washed. In John chapter 13, Jesus came to the disciples. He takes off his clothing, he girds himself with a towel, and he begins to wash the disciples' feet one by one, and he comes to Peter. And Peter says to him, wait, Jesus, you're washing my feet? And Jesus says, what I'm doing, you don't understand now, but one day you will. Peter says, absolutely not. You will never wash my feet. That's the job of a slave. There's no way I'm going to allow you to wash my feet. And Jesus says to him, if I don't wash you, you have no part with me. If I don't cleanse you, we are not intimate. Now, this isn't talking about baptism. This isn't talking about salvation. This is the fact that when we walk in the world, we pick up dirt and sin and stench, don't we? And so when we want to be used, we have to be washed anew each time. We need to wash our feet. And then Peter says, well, then wash me all, Lord. Wash me from head to toe. No, Peter, you don't get it. You've already been washed from head to toe. You just need your feet to be washed because that is what touches the soil. That is what touches the earth. That is where the sin is picked up. It's symbolic. You need to cleanse yourself from sin. Do you feel dirty this morning? Do you feel, when you walked in here this morning, did you feel like, I don't even feel worthy to walk in those doors? I know God is watching and I know he doesn't like what he sees. You realize there's a promise in Scripture? The promise is found in 1 John chapter 1, it says that if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If you feel like you've picked up some sin and some dirt along the way, you come to God and you confess that to God. You don't confess that to me. I'm not your priest that needs to hear what you've done. I don't care about all of your business. I don't need to know what you've done, but you go to God and you say, God, forgive me. You bear your heart, your soul open to him, and you say, God, wash me clean. And the scripture says, when you confess your sin, he is faithful and he is just to forgive you of that sin and to cleanse it. To cleanse it, to wash it. If you're going to be a vessel God can use, you have to be washed. Now, you also, as a vessel, you must desire to be used. Do you desire to be used? Do you even desire to be useful? That word useful in 2 Timothy, it means something that is serviceable, something that is of use. It's beneficial. It is helpful. Now, if you're going to be a vessel that God can use, I'm going to give you 6 things here that you're going to write down that I want you to consider, because as I was considering, Lord, I want to be useful. I read this text just like you read this text. I read this text and I say, God, I'm convicted because I want to make sure that I'm being used the way you want to use me. How can I be more used? What can I do, God, so that you can use me more powerfully? And these are the words the Lord spoke to me. First off, first word, a vessel needs to be reachable. In 1 Samuel chapter 3, we read of Samuel, a young man. He hasn't even heard the voice of God yet till this time. And he hears someone say, Samuel. And he gets up and he goes in to check on the high priest Eli. Goes in to check on Eli. Eli, what's going on? I didn't call you. Go back to bed. A second time, Samuel. He goes in to check with Eli. Eli, you called me. I heard you. What's going on? I didn't call you. Go back to bed. A third time, he goes in to say, Eli, what's going on? Eli says, I know what's happening here. You're hearing God for the first time. God is reaching you. God is speaking to you. You go back, and when you hear that voice again, say, here's your servant. What can I do? Are you reachable? Are you listening for God's voice? When your life is so inundated with stuff and priorities and responsibilities and your schedule is completely full all the time, do you have a moment just to come aside and to say, God, I want you to speak to me. I want to hear from you today. Elijah experiences this amazing thing happens. This wind sweeps through and breaks apart everything. And the scripture says, God was not in the wind. And then an earthquake. The earth shook, but God wasn't in the earthquake. And then a fire rages and consumes everything, but God wasn't in the fire. But God was in the whisper, the scripture says. Do you feel far from God this morning? Could it be that God is trying to whisper to you, but you haven't been listening? You're not reachable? Even Saul, who was going around persecuting the church, he was on his way to Damascus to imprison more people, to bring them bound back to Jerusalem so that they might be ripped apart from their families, so that they could be tortured and punished and maybe put to death. On his way to go persecute the church, a light shines around him and he falls on his feet. Or falls on his face before the Lord, and he says, who are you, Lord? And he says, Jesus replies, it's Jesus, the one whom you've been persecuting. It's hard for you to kick against the goads. Now, what are the goads? The goad is a long pruning stick, a prodding stick, with a hook, a sharp point on the end, that a shepherd would use to direct its sheep or its oxen. And so that point, if the point at the end of the stick, the staff, would be prodded into the nose or into the face of the animal to keep the animal going in the direction the shepherd wanted. Jesus says to Paul, or to Saul, you are that animal, you're being stubborn. I'm trying to speak to you, but you're not listening, so I'm blinding you. I'm going to make it so you can't see or hear anything else because I'm trying to reach you, Saul. I have a plan for you, Saul. I want to use you, Saul. Saul, a murderer, a persecutor. God wanted to use him and had a plan for that man's life. You think God can't use you this morning? But have you been reachable? Is God maybe speaking loudly to you, but you're not paying attention? So Saul answers, here I am, Lord. What do you want me to do? What can I do? Here I am. What can I do? How can I be used? Finally, he comes to the point of surrender. He lays down the fight. He lays aside his stubbornness. God, how can I be used of you? What do you want me to do? Now read this later on, Jeremiah chapter 18, write this down. And read about how God gave a word to Jeremiah in the house of a potter, and how Jeremiah went in and he saw this potter fashioning his pot, his vessel. But the vessel wasn't right, and so the potter had to scrap the entire thing, collapsed the lump of clay, and started over and began to fashion that vase, that vessel, all over again. And God says to Jeremiah, that's what the nation of Israel is like. I can do with it whatever I want because I'm the potter and it's the vessel. Listen, my friends, you are not the potter. You are the vessel. And God can do with you whatever he wants. Have you surrendered yet? I don't care how broken or tattered or dirty you feel right now in this moment. When you cry out to God, when you surrender like Saul did, who became Paul, the Apostle Paul, when you cry out in that way, you say, Lord, what? When you become like Samuel, Lord, what can I do? When you become like Isaiah, in Isaiah chapter 6, here am I, Lord, use me. When you answer God's call, just wait to see what he will do once you finally truly surrender. Listen to what God said of Saul just a few verses later after this happens in verse 15. He says, go, speak to Saul, for he is a chosen vessel of mine to bear my name before the Gentiles, the kings, and the children of Israel. He's my chosen vessel. 1 minute persecuting the church, 1 minute a murderer, the next he's God's chosen vessel. What was the difference? What transpired between those few verses? The difference is Saul finally surrendered. Have you surrendered this morning? So a vessel has to be reachable. Secondly, a vessel must be available. The most useful vessel that you have in your home are the vessels that you keep close by. Is that not true? Now, in the cupboard that you keep right next to the sink, do you keep the fine china or do you keep the everyday stuff? Or maybe the paper plates, right? Whatever you use the most, that's what you keep the closest to you. I want to be available to God. I want to be the one that he uses the most. I want to be the one that is there when he needs to call. I want to be close to God. And if you keep yourself far removed from God's presence, how is he able to call upon you to be used? Are you available for his use? Next, a vessel must be versatile. And I pondered this and I said, Lord, I want to be as useful to you as possible. Now, I have a tool belt at home, and in that tool belt, there's a big pouch, right? And there's a pouch that you can keep like nails and screws in, and then you have the big pouch, and there's a holster on this side. It's a really cool tool belt, right? I got a holster for a drill, I got a holster for my hammer, and then I got a pouch for all of my other tools, my wrenches and my screwdrivers and those types of things. And so all of these different tools, they each serve a different purpose, right? But I also have a utility tool or a tool that has many different purposes, a multi-tool in that belt. Because when I don't have the other, or when I really need something that maybe is more versatile, I can reach to that and it's good for different uses. There's a saw on it. There's a screwdriver on it. There's some scissors on it. There's tweezers on it. It's useful for many different things. And when I'm there close to the Lord, available to be used, I want to have as many gifts and talents available for his use as possible. Are you looking at it that way? Do you want to be used by God? I bought a guitar a long time ago, and I started playing guitar. And I can play guitar. How many of you guys have ever seen me play guitar up here? Ever? Anyone? There's a reason for that. There's a reason you never see me play guitar. But in a pinch, for a home fellowship or for a Bible study, I could play guitar and lead worship because I want to be available to be used if God needs someone to lead worship. I don't want to be there and for God to say, well, I would have used you if maybe you had put forth some effort. In the way I came through church, as I started, I started serving in the base things and the common things, cleaning bathrooms and toilets. And then God just started moving me forward, and because I said, Lord, I want to be used however you need to be used. I'm versatile. I'm not going to put myself in a box. I'm not going to say these are the things I enjoy and these things I don't. So God, I give you permission to use me in things I enjoy, but not in things I don't. It's not about me, it's about him, right? Our worship and our usefulness is not about us. It's about bringing God glory. So I want to be versatile. I want the Lord to be able to use me, but I also want to be flexible. This morning, for instance, this is kind of being a little flexible for me. This is outside my comfort zone, right? I have 1 week in the midst of a few weeks when Walt is going to be preaching, and I'm preaching today, actually, because something came up with his mom, and his mom was sick, and she had to have surgery. And so I'm here preaching. There's no sermon series. There's no plan. It's just, I just have to share with you a word God puts on my heart. That is uncomfortable for me. I like to plan things out. I like to know the direction that I'm going, right? And so that's difficult for me to do, but I'm going to be flexible because I know that it's not about me, but it's about God. It's about what he might want to do in me. Remember Moses in Exodus chapter 4? God is calling Moses to go liberate his people. I want you to lead my people from Egypt. Moses says, hold on, God. He looks around like this probably. You're talking to me? You've got the wrong guy. I'm slow of tongue. I don't speak well. I'm not a dynamic orator. I don't think that I can lead people in that way. And God says this to him. He says, you just be quiet. Who has made man's mouth? Who makes the mute, the deaf, the seeing, or the blind? Have not I the Lord? Now therefore go, and I will be with your mouth and teach you what to say. I will do it in you. I will do it through you. I'm just a vessel that God uses because I make myself available. Because I say, Lord, I'm going to be flexible. I want to be used by you. And I don't care how that looks or what it has to or what I have to do as long as I'm being used by you, Lord. I'll tell you how serious this is for me, all right? Tuesday night, I had a nightmare that I came out here on stage and I couldn't find my Bible. So I went down and there was a child sitting in the front row and I grabbed his Bible and I came open and I was getting ready to preach and I opened it up and it's a comic book. So I took that Bible back to him and I went over and there was a lady sitting over here and I grabbed her Bible and I opened it up, but it was written in some women language. I couldn't even read it. It was like written just for women, and I knew I was not going to understand what was written there, so I took that back. That's how unsettled I was. I don't enjoy speaking in front of people. That's not me, believe it or not. But you know what? I know that I'm just a vessel. I said, Lord, it's not about me. It's never been about me. I never want it to be about me. I want it to be about you. I'm just an empty vessel for you to fill, Lord. So a vessel has to be versatile, but the vessel also has to be faithful. How many of you have found that to be the case in life? You have to be faithful to the Lord. You've got to be. Jesus says, no one puts his hands to the plow to start working, looking over his shoulder, is fit for the kingdom of God. That word fit means useful. If you put your hands to the plow and you're constantly looking over your shoulder, thinking about the things that you've left behind, Jesus says, you're not useful to me. That's not what I'm looking for. I'm looking for someone who will put his hands to the plow and will plow forward. Listen to what he says in Matthew chapter 10, verse 37 through 39. He says, he who loves his father or his mother more than me is not worthy of me. He who loves his son or his daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And he who does not take up his cross and follow after me is not worthy of me. He who finds his life will lose it, and he who loses his life for my sake will find it. He says, I want all of you, or I don't want any of you. I want you entirely. I'm a jealous God, and I'm not willing to share your heart with anyone because I gave you my heart completely. I gave you my everything, and I want your everything in return. You have to be faithful as a vessel to be used by God, but you also, and maybe this is the most important, you have to be humble. You have to be humble. Listen to what James 4:6 says, but he gives more grace. Therefore, he says, God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. The word resists, it means opposes. God opposes the proud. He sets himself against the proud, but he just gives more grace to those who are humble. Which side of that equation do you want to be on? Which side of that verse do you want to be on? You want to be the one God opposes because you come in your pride thinking that God should use you because you're the most gifted and you're the most eloquent and you're the best looking, right? Yeah, God really got a prize when he gained me. Good job, God. You chose me first in line. That's a good job. God's going to oppose you. He's going to withstand you. He's going to place himself against you. But the humble that comes and says, Lord, I am not worthy to be used. I'm nothing without you. God's just going to shower grace upon grace upon grace, and I want to be walking in that grace. Look at Peter as opposed to Paul, right? Both of them became humbled, right? Peter came from a very humble background, just a fisherman. Paul, he was learned, and he knew a lot, and he was trained under the best rabbis, but Peter, he was just a simple fisherman. He just fished his little heart out till one day Jesus says, come follow me. And Peter responded, and he did follow Jesus. God can use both. He can use the most learned individual, and he can use the one who doesn't have a degree, doesn't have all of the training and all the learning. What matters isn't how much you know right now. All that matters to God is whether or not you're going to be used by him. You're going to surrender to that call. God's calling you all to be his vessels this morning. Will you respond? Will you say, Lord, I'm here. I'm your guy. So a vessel has to be desire to be usable or used, but it also must desire to be prepared. How many of you have actually prepared yourself to be used by God? The scripture says in 2 Timothy 4:2, preach the word, be ready in season and out of season. You be ready. You be ready so that when I call you, you are prepared. You be in the word. You be taking in the word. You be about God's business. You be preparing yourself for the moment I call. It's like the batter sitting on the bench, and he's watched the entire game, but he's sitting on the edge of his seat just hoping that the coach will call his name because he's put in the preparation. He's put in the work, and he cannot wait to step into that batter's box and to show the rest of the team and everyone watching the game what he has learned, how he has prepared. Are you that one just waiting to be called? Lord, I prepared myself for you. How do you prepare yourself? You prepare yourself first off through diet. An athlete prepares itself first off by paying attention to its diet. Jesus says, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Right? I'm going to be nourished by God's word. In Philippians chapter 4, verse 8, Paul says this. He says, finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are good report, if there's any virtue and if there's anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. Think about these things. Let these things fill your mind. Let these things fill your heart. Let these things captivate your attention. Don't meditate on all the junk, all the trash. Consider and pray over and reckon and reason about the things that are pure and just and praiseworthy and that are of good report. Is that what your diet looks like? Or are you filling your mind and your heart with trash, with junk, with rubbish? So an athlete prepares himself through diet, but also through exercise. Through exercise. James 1:22 says that we should be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving ourselves. We have to bring the word in, but we have to let the word out. If not, it's just spiritual obesity. We're just fattening ourselves up, right? If we're not exercising the word, if we're not doing the word. Now, there are two C's. In Israel, the Sea of Galilee, which is teeming with life and bustling, and it was a huge place where they would fish, and the fishing industry was very fruitful in that area because there was an inlet for the water and there was an outlet for the water. But there's also the Dead Sea, And the Dead Sea just has an inlet and no outlet. And the water just gets there and it just, it becomes a cesspool. There's nothing that can live in that sea because there's too many compounds in that water. Which sea are you this morning? Are you the Sea of Galilee, fruitful and teeming and abounding with life because the word that comes in also comes out? You let it in and then you speak it forth, or are you the Dead Sea? You're just receiving, 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 and it just stagnates, and it just spoils, and there's nothing that can live therein. Paul said this to Timothy. He says, you reject profane and old wives' fables and exercise yourself towards godliness. Exercise to discipline and to train yourself towards godliness. How can we prepare ourselves to be used spiritually? How can we make sure that our vessels are usable by God? The scripture says this. Jesus says this, that the way you prepare yourself to be used is through prayer and through fasting. They go together. You pray, you expose your heart, you open your heart to God, and you allow God to speak to you, and then you fast. You deny your flesh. You say no to your flesh. I will not give in to you, flesh. You pray, draw closer to God, and you fast. You separate yourself from the flesh. He says, that's how you're going to be ready to be used. How's your prayer and your fasting life look? When was the last time you said, you know what, I'm going to skip meals today. I'm just not going to eat today so that I can draw closer to God, so that I prepare this vessel of mine to be used. Do you want to be used? You have to desire to be used by God. And your last main point there, so we as a church have become unsatisfied. We're unclean, which means we're unusable, which means we're unsatisfied. We haven't been filled. Listen to this verse again in 2 Timothy. It says, therefore, if anyone cleanses himself from the latter, he will be a vessel for honor, sanctified and useful for the master, prepared for every good work. That is how you'll find satisfaction. That is how you will find a way for you to be filled with God. That's how you're going to be really, truly lifted up and encouraged. Are you useful? What is your source of satisfaction? Jesus was asked by his disciples, why haven't you been eating? You need to eat. Here, let us give you some food. You need to eat. Jesus says, you don't understand. You haven't been watching closely enough. He says, I have food that you can't even imagine. He says, my food is to do the will of the Father who sent me and to finish his work. That's how I find nourishment. That's how I find satisfaction. That's how I find fulfillment in life, by doing what God sent me to do. And the church is unsatisfied. You as an individual might be sitting there this morning completely and utterly unsatisfied because you're not doing what God created you to do. You're not a vessel that God can use. My food is to do the will of the Father who sent me. Listen to this in Colossians chapter 2. Beware lest anyone cheat you through philosophy and empty deceit, according to the traditions of men and according to the basic principles of the world, and not according to Christ. For in Christ dwells all of the fullness of God. In Christ is fullness. In Christ is satisfaction. When you get to the point to where you're once again usable by God, you can find fulfillment and satisfaction. My friends, it's time that we do some housekeeping. It's time that we cleanse ourselves from the inside out of all of the junk and filth that we've taken into our vessels so that God can fill us with his Spirit. That's what our vessel was created to soak in. Paul says this, he says, as God has said, I will dwell in them, and I will walk among them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Therefore, come out from among them and be separate, says the Lord. Come away with me. Separate yourself with me, says the Lord. Don't touch what is unclean, and I will receive you. I will be a father to you. You shall be my sons and my daughters, says the Almighty, the Lord Almighty. Therefore, having these promises, beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all the filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. Come away with me, says the Lord. Cleanse yourself of all of that filth. Come be separate with me, says God. Eliminate your contact with all of those impure and unrighteous things. Cleanse yourself so that you're prepared to be the vessel that I created you to be. Write this verse down and commit this verse to memory. 2 Corinthians 4:7. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. That we have this treasure in earthen vessels. We are this vessel. We are this vase. We are this container. And it's empty until we invite God to come and to fill it. And then when God fills it, once we've emptied ourselves of the unrighteous things, the filth, the dirt, we empty that vessel. We pour it out. We turn it over. God, I don't want any of that any longer. And we pick it back up. We set it up. We say, Lord, I'm clean now. I want to be filled with you. The scripture's clear that he puts his treasure, he puts his spirit inside a common vessel, a vessel made of clay. Who in their right mind puts their most valuable treasure inside a vessel of clay? We as men, we put our treasures in banks and in safes. God says, I put my spirit in you, my vessel. I will put my treasure in you, my vessel, if you will prepare that vessel to be used. If you will make sure that you are sanctified so that you might be usable, so that you might be prepared. I want to use you as my vessel. And God is calling you, my friends, this morning. He was calling you forward. He's calling you to say, empty, empty, come empty. Come empty to him because he wants to fill you. He wants to fill you so that you cannot be filled with any more. He wants to pour out on you so much more than you can even imagine or think, the scripture says. But the question is are you ready? Do you desire it? Is it what your heart yearns for? Is it what you're longing for right now? Can you feel the Spirit wooing you and speaking to you even in this moment, saying, that is all I desire. That is what I want. That is what I require. Because God will meet you in that place. You draw near to God, he will meet you in that place. You come with your empty vessel. You come as a beggar. You come saying, God, I'm so empty. I'm lacking. I have need. Lord, I'm desperate for you. You come with that empty vessel, and God will put his treasure inside you. He will fill your vessel with his spirit if you'll respond. If you'll say, God, that's what I need. God, that's all I long for. That's what I want. He will fill your vessel. Your vessel was made to be filled by him. You come and God will meet you in that place. You say, Lord, here I am, your empty servant. Say, God, all I want is you. God, all I need is you. I feel broken. I feel beaten. I feel dented. I feel used. I feel dirty. But Lord, not anymore. Lord, I don't have to be that way anymore. Not in your eyes. I can come and I can be cleansed. I can come in the pieces of my life. The pieces of my life you can put back together and I can be usable again. God wants to do that in your life. He doesn't want you to leave still having that aching feeling in your heart, that feeling of discontentment and unsatisfaction, feeling unsatisfied and empty. He wants to fill you. He wants to fill you to the brim. He wants to fill you to overflowing. You just have to say, God, here are my hands. Here I am, Lord, I'm empty. Fill me. I want your treasure inside this vessel. I need your treasure inside this vessel. When you sing this song, stand with us this morning. Stand with us, and if the Spirit is calling you, you respond. You say, Lord, here I am. Here I am, your vessel. Sing this song. We're all broken. We're all tattered. We all have a past. We all have issues, but God says no more. He says, throw that off. Unclothe yourself. That's not who you are anymore, believer. You can put on Christ. You can take in his Spirit. You can drink it in. You to overflowing, you will never be the same again. God wants to do that in your life this morning. Do you believe it? Do you believe it?
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. the broken to life.
That's what God does. He raises up the broken into life. And the pieces of your life, the shatteredness of your soul, you bring to Him and you offer up whatever pieces there are. And He raises it up to usefulness and to life. Only God can do that. You can't find that anywhere else. You can only find that in the presence of Jesus. You can only find purpose and meaning and truth and hope when you open your heart to the Lord and you allow Him to flood every crevice and every crack of your soul, your spirit. Let Him flood into you. Let Him pour into you and receive all that He has. My friends, we know the words to this. There isn't a single one of us who can't sing Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound. Saved a wretch like me. Let's sing this all together. Let's raise our hands to the Lord. Let's lift our voices to Him. And in all sincerity and in all truth, let's say, Lord, this is for You. This is an offering for You. This is what I have to bring as a gift to You. And allow the Lord to meet you in that. that space. In the space of your brokenness, you'll find healing and hope and purpose once again. You don't have to leave here empty. You can be filled. Let's sing that together. Amazing grace. Amazing grace. Raise your hands to the Lord. Everyone together. Father, I'm so thankful for you. I'm so thankful for the gift of your Spirit. I'm so thankful for how you speak to our hearts. I'm so thankful that you weren't willing to allow us to suffer and to wallow in our sin and in that mire any longer. But God, you sent your Son Jesus. You sent him to a cross in my place, in our place, so that we could find forgiveness, so that we could find a future and a hope, the hope that you speak of. And Lord, I pray that my friends would walk in the power of the Spirit. I pray, God, that you would anoint them. God, that they would take the hand off the top of their vessel. God, that they would expose themselves completely. And Father, that you would fill them to overflowing, that there wouldn't be a portion of them left that hasn't been touched by your Spirit. God, I pray your power over them. I pray, God, that you would keep them pure and unspotted in a world that is so filthy. God, that they would commit their lives purely to you, God, in purity, that they would seek you, heart, soul, mind, and strength, that they would love you more than anything else in the world, God, that their hearts would remain true. And God, I pray that you would birth within these people a desire to see the gospel break forth in this community. Lord, that through these people, that lives would be changed, that lepers would be cleansed, that sinners would be set free. Lord, that your church would be multiplied through the passion that these friends of mine here in this sanctuary right now with me in this moment, that they would have for seeing people set free, for that gospel. It is the power of God into salvation. We believe it. Lord, help us to walk it. Lord, I pray a blessing over them. I pray, Father, that you would watch over them in Jesus' name. We're going to continue to worship. I invite you to stay. I invite you to stay. I invite you to stay. There's no hurry. There's no rush. Stay and enjoy God's presence. Come be broken. Come say, Lord, I need you. Come say, God, I want to be filled. He will meet you in this place. Don't rush the Lord. Don't rush the Lord. Amen. Is there anywhere else better that you could possibly be than right here in God's presence right now? I don't think so. Enjoy God's presence.